Take your Bibles, let's turn to the book of Revelation. It's good to see Mel and Judith back, and appreciate the great song. Those people that got up and walked out, they were all in the early service. I just want you to know. It's not like they have something against me. Maybe something that. This morning we're going to go back to school of Revelation. We're going to be looking at the lady in red. That's always a great title, I think. Chapter 17, 18, and 19 of the book of Revelation. We are introduced to three different ladies. Two of them are called Babylon, but they actually have different characteristics. They're identified in different ways. If you recall, last time we got together in chapter 16, the bowls were being poured out of God's judgment upon the earth. And now we're going to see John being escorted again into a wilderness place by one of the angels that was pouring out one of the bowls. And we get to see some things that are taking place around the pouring out of these bowls. And I think it's really important for us to understand just a couple of things as we start digging into this. I really believe that the lady in red, that's the first one that we meet. It's kind of ironic. There's a lady in red. There's a lady that's blue. She's very, very sad. That's in chapter 18. And then the last one is the lady that's adorned in white. And that's the bride of Christ, which you and I get to be a part of. And so you and I as believers, as followers of Christ, we get to participate and be a part of the lady in white. But the first two are words of warning. The first is going to be about any kind of religious movement that tries to exist apart from God. And the second is about any kind of government or economic movement that seeks to have an existence apart from God. Now, I realize that this is, again, different kind of teaching than we normally follow when you see all the charts and everything in the graphs. But we're going to understand the highlights of this, because if the book of Revelation is primarily about a revelation of Jesus Christ, then what we need to understand is that the kingdom of God is superior to any religious movement that might be in competition to who he is. Any religious movement. That would take in the worship of nature, which is very prominent, very popular today. It would take in emperor worship, which would have been very pronounced in John's day. All the Caesars claimed to be a god. It would take into account a lot of the New Age religions that seem to be emerging now and that have been going on throughout history. Any religious movement, any spirituality that tries to exist apart from God is a deception from the beast. And we need to understand that. We need to understand the characteristics, because the compromising church will be judged. The church that compromises on God, the church that seeks to exist apart from a relationship with God, will come under judgment. And so we need to be sure that we are among the faithful church, because our Savior will be victorious. Jesus is going to win in the end. Turn to the person on your right and the person on your left and tell them, be ready, judgment's coming. Tell them. Revelation chapter 17, verse 1. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it so I'll know we're ready to read. Listen to what the Word of God says. Get your outlines out. We'll be working through it together. Listen to what it says. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked to me, saying, remember, the angels were pouring out the bowls back in chapter 16. It was the coming judgment. So listen to what he says. Come and I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So here is a woman being portrayed for us that is unfaithful to her first love. She's unfaithful to the one that she should be loving. There's something wrong with this picture. She's said to be a woman wearing scarlet. Let's keep going. Verse 3. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw the woman sitting on a scarlet beast, which was full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed with purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hands a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And on her forehead was a name that was written, Mystery Babylon, the great, the mother of harlots and the abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement. There's something being portrayed here about this this unfaithful woman in red that has left her first love and has actually participated in the attacks and the assaults and the persecution of God's people. Let's keep reading. Verse 7. But the angel said to me, "Why did you marvel? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition. And those who dwell on the earth will marvel, those whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they see the beast that was and is not and yet is." There's a warning there about the book being written in the book of life, because it's going to be very easy to get caught up into this woman in red, to pursue her, to marvel at her because of her opulence, because of all of her wealth, because of her influence. It's going to be really easy to get confused and to follow the wrong teaching, to be caught up in this woman. Verse 9, "Here is the mind which is wisdom. The 7 heads are the 7 mountains on which the woman sits." Those 7 mountains, normally when you talk about the city of Rome, it was talked about in being the city of 7 hills, 7 mountains. And so this is probably a reference to, in John's day, what was taking place in Rome at the time. And in Rome, there was a religious movement where the Caesars actually believed and confessed and encouraged others to worship them as gods. And so this woman in red, is a reflection of a religious system that tries to exist apart from a relationship with the true and the living God. Now, you're in this way if you follow me so far. You don't have to agree as long as you follow me. Okay? I'll convince you to agree as we get further into it. So let's keep going. Verse 12. "The 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings who have received no kingdom as yet, but they have received authority for 1 hour as kings with the beast." We're not going to worry about who the 10 kings are and all that stuff. Let's keep going. Verse 13. "These are of one mind, and they will give their power and their authority to the beast." So whatever we say about this woman, there's some allegiance to the beast here that's come up out of the pit. Okay, keep going. Verse 14. "These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for He is the Lord of lords and the King of kings, and those who are with Him are called chosen and faithful." You might want to put a star by that verse. That's our hope. Compromising religious movements, compromising churches that seek to exist, that have no spiritual depth. Listen to me. You can have all the glamour and the glitter that you want, but if the glory of God doesn't abide there, you are not the church of God. Do I need to say that one again? You can look good on the outside, but if God is not present on the inside, there's a problem. And that's what we're talking about here, this woman in red. Let's finish it up. Verse 14, "These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for He is the Lord of lords and the King of kings, and those who are with Him are called chosen and faithful." And then He said to me, "The waters which you saw where the harlot sits are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues." These are the ones that the woman in red has deceived and dominated. So what it means is this: there's going to be a falling away. There's going to be a great deception that will take place, and many people will be caught up in the deception of the woman in red. Verse 16, "And the 10 horns which you saw on the beast, these will hate the harlot and make her desolate and naked and eat her flesh and burn her with fire." The harlot enters into this compact, this agreement with these kings of the world. And when the kings of the world are through with her, they will turn then on her and attack this compromising church. Check verse 17. Why? Why does all this happen? "For God put it in their hearts to fulfill His purpose, to be of one mind, and to give their kingdom to the beast until the words of God are fulfilled. And the woman who you saw is the great city which reigns over the kings of the earth." Verse 17 is really important. "But God has put it in their hearts." This is all for free, and some of you won't like it, but I'm going to tell you anyway, because it's what the Bible teaches. We have to understand that nothing, say nothing, nothing happens on this earth that our God is not in control of. Don't care how the elections turned out. Doesn't matter. Either God ordained it or He allowed it. Revelation says that this woman in red was simply accomplishing what God said had to happen. And the allegiance that came together with the woman in red, the kings of the earth, the governments of the earth that were working with that king of the earth, was only fulfilling the word of God, fulfilling the will of God, accomplishing what God intended from the beginning. God's intent is not to take sides. He's not Democratic or Republican. God's intent is that the King of Kings reign. He came to take over, not to take sides. I want you to think with me for just a minute about this woman in red. Let's look at the truth. Get your outlines out. Let's look at it together. The truth about the lady in red. I believe the lady in red can be found in every generation. I believe that the lady in red represents the church who compromises their faith. It is the church who seeks to exist without an intimate connection with the true and the living God. I got news for you. There are churches today in our world that seek to go through the motions. They call themselves a church, but the only person not welcome there is God. The only one not invited in is God. Everything else goes, anything else anybody wants to do, it's all good, but God can't show up. Now, the biggest problem we face in our culture and our society today is trying to figure out which of these three women we're going to meet, we want to be a part of. Some of us are very much involved in government and economics, and so we want to follow after that woman. And some of us are very much into spirituality, and we want to follow this woman. We better be people that find ourselves dressed in white. We want to be the woman in white who's going to show up. So think with me for just a minute. We'll talk about the woman in white later. Let's talk about the lady in red. Number one, first thing we need to understand is the compromising church will be judged. The church that compromises, it will be judged. Come and I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, the woman that left her first love, this church that has come in with kings and entered into fornication. The inhabitants of the earth are made drunk with the wine of her fornication. You know, there are churches today that are more interested in being popular than to be prophetic. And there are churches today that want to be politically correct instead of biblically sound. And anytime a church begins to compromise on its stand, on its position when it comes to the Word of God, it is a compromising church. And I've got news for you. The compromising church, even in this generation, will be judged. God will hold it accountable. There will be a time that will come when the church that seeks to exist apart from God will have to stand before Him and give an accounting. Now remember, we're not talking about the institution, we're talking about the individuals that make up the body. Okay? You got to realize, First Baptist Church is not the building that keeps the weather out. I'm glad we got it. It'd be an awfully cold day for me to be up here preaching if we didn't have a building, but I got news for you. You are the church, and you are the church, and I am the church. And we must be a people that refuse to compromise, that refuse to try to exist apart from the power and the presence of God. We don't want to just look good on the outside. We want to experience His presence on the inside. Because if we don't have His presence on the inside, we've given up the right to call ourselves a church. If our first love is anything besides Him, we have become the woman in red. Okay, buckle up. Democrats and Republicans, I need to put you on notice. Your political party should not take the place of God. Your allegiance to your party should not take the place of your relationship with God. See, sometimes my fear is we start worshiping parties. We leave our first love. We start focusing on, you don't how much money they spent politicking this year? Between $5 and $6 billion with a B, dollars. Why is that? I'll tell you why. Because somebody's worshiping at the altar of the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. Oh, you can be mad if you want to. I'm an equal opportunity offender. I think both of them are wrong. I worship the true and the living God. That's where my allegiance needs to go. Not to anybody or anything else. So we see this, that the compromising church is going to be judged. You know, you can trace any kind of collapse of any society, any institution, any nation, any church, any man will be traced back to compromise. The collapse of any of them will be traced back to compromise. When the church becomes bedfellows with kings and political systems like this woman did, it leads to compromising faith. And when it leads to a compromising faith, it will be judged. I remember a day when we first started growing so rapidly around here. This is what I heard in the community. I heard people say, you can't run for office in Odessa without being a member of the Baptist Church. Now, let me tell you something. That was never my desire. I don't care. I'm glad that Adam's the mayor. Don't get me wrong, Steve, but I don't care who the mayor is. I tell you what I do care about. I do care about who sits on the throne of your life. Because if Jesus Christ isn't on the throne of my life, isn't on the throne of your life, I've become a compromiser. I've become infatuated by the woman in red. Don't want to do that. Don't want to go there. So the compromising church will be judged. Second thing we discover. Number two, her wealth cannot stop it. Notice what it says. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of the abominations of the filthiness of her fornication. She was popular. She was dressed to the nines. She looked good on the outside. She was pretty and popular. But when it comes to compromising God's word, she was nothing. There are churches that believe that they're too big and too wealthy for God to judge. Kind of like that old man that's rich enough to buy a sports car, only to realize he's too big to fit behind the wheel anymore, you know? There are a lot of people in our world today that really believe that their church is so big. Their church has a lot of money. You know, there are churches that have enough of an endowment that they will never have to close their door. They can always pay the preacher, but God never shows up on Sunday. There's never anybody in the seats. God never moves in any powerful, powerful way. Somebody came to me one day and said, you know what, if I ever win the lottery, I'm going to give the church a lot of money so that we can build a new sanctuary. And I told him this, that'd be the worst thing that ever happened to this church. Because you know why? Because you need a buy-in. If somebody pays your way, we take it for granted. We start feeling entitled. There are churches in England today that got a lot of money in the bank. They can keep the doors open, but nobody shows up and attends. I'd rather be in a place where the roof is falling in, but God shows up on Sunday, than a place that's pretty. It looks like a museum. God never attends. God never says anything. God never does anything. Oh, you guys are awfully quiet. Her wealth cannot stop it. Today, many churches, they've got all the glitz and the glitter, but none of the glory, none of the glow. Third thing, her influence cannot prevent it. Notice what happens. This woman whom you saw is that great city which reigns over the kings of the earth. It said that this woman, this compromising church, had a lot of influence. They could rule over the kings. They could influence politics. They could influence the government. They could do all kinds of things. But guess what? She was still judged. Sometimes we think because we've got a lot of money that God is blessing us. That's not a sign of God's blessing. Wealth is not a sign of God's blessing. Influence is not a sign that we're biblical. It could be that we're compromising on the Word. People just want to go to the church that compromises on the Word. You know what? If we don't require much of you, everybody wants to be a part of that. Don't give me a preacher that wants you to be committed to something. Got to go deep. Got to walk with Him. See, the deeper I go with Him, the more of His nature rubs off on me. The more I begin to look like Him and act like Him. Her wealth cannot stop it. Her influence cannot prevent it. Number four, her numbers cannot ease it. Notice what it says about this woman. And then He said to me, the waters which you saw where the harlots sits are the peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. Listen, you do not find the true measure of a church in its wealth, in its influence, or in its numbers. Bigger does not always mean better. And richer does not always mean spiritual. And influential does not mean that you abide under the blessing of God. Sometimes that can simply be a sign that we're the compromising church. Here's what I would start asking if I were sitting where you were. I'd start asking, is this a compromising church? Because one day the wrath of God will be poured out. The bowls will be poured out. I don't want to be a part of this woman in red. That's why I'm preaching this message today. See, a lot of pastors wouldn't do this. Because I've offended about everybody, Democrats and Republicans. These girls down here are getting ready to throw rocks at me. I don't know what's going on. See, the reality is the compromising church cannot escape God's judgment just because it's got a lot of influence. Just because they have notoriety. The church that compromises on the Word of God, on the ways of God, on the will of God, it's coming into judgment. It's inescapable. It will happen. It will happen. So here's the question that I want to know the answer to. How can I overcome the woman in red? How can I be sure that I'm not part of that group? Because listen, the group exists today. It exists in our world today. There are churches that will stand up and defend everything except the teachings of Jesus Christ. It's just the way it is. It's just the way it is. So think with me for just a minute about how to overcome the church. Number one, first thing, you better be connected to Christ. You want to overcome the lady in red, you must be connected to Christ. Notice what it says. The beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. His destiny is already set, but that's the evil one. And those who dwell on the earth will marvel. Don't get caught up in how big or how pretty it looks. They will marvel. But they're only the ones whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. There's the key. You want to avoid the woman in red? You make sure your name is written in the book of life. You make sure that you personally are connected to God. The way to make sure that you're not part of the church that compromises is first and foremost to make sure you are connected to Him. Make sure that you have a personal walk and relationship with Him. Because the more you walk with Him, the deeper you go with Him, the more influence He has on your life, the more discerning you can be. How many of you know that we live in a day and an age where we need to be very discerning because there are truths and there are lies that are circulated everywhere? My goodness, we just finished the political season. Think of the truths and the lies and half-truths. You know, a half-truth is nothing more than a whole lie. But think of all of the misinformation that was spewed out about all kinds of people, all kinds of issues, all kinds of things. My goodness, why would any decent person ever want to run for office in this country if you're going to be regurgitated on like that? No, here's the way to overcome the woman in red. The way to overcome the woman in red is to be connected to the one who shed blood. Now notice what it said. It said, who has their names written in the book of life. That's not on the Baptist Church's membership record. It's the book of life. That's a different book. That's not on a particular denomination's membership roles. That's a different book. We're talking about genuine stuff here. We're talking about the book of life. Because see, many of the compromising church are people who have their names on church rolls. Preacher, am I getting in your business yet? People who have their names written on church rolls who are not connected to Jesus. they're connected to a lady in red. So the first thing that I need to do is be sure that I'm connected to Him. Second thing I need to do is I must be committed to follow Him. Notice what it says here. And these will make war with the Lamb, those that the woman in red and the kings that she's in bed with. They will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. And those who are with Him are called this, chosen and faithful. There we go. I want to be faithful. My claim to a connection to Him is seen in my commitment to Him. You know, it's time for us to move beyond just claiming Christianity as our faith. It's time for us to be committed to the person of Jesus Christ. Listen, if Revelation is true, and I believe it is, it's going to get worse before it gets better. Persecution is going to break out against God's people and against God's church. And I will tell you, when persecution breaks out, something will happen. You know what? This place is pretty well packed, this service. But if persecution was breaking out, you know what? People whose commitments are shallow, whose commitments are weak, they won't be here. You want to overcome the woman in red? Because this is what they'll say. I can go to that church. Nobody's attacking them. I can be spiritual. That's a real popular thing. I'm a spiritual person, but not religious. Yeah. I got to tell you something. When the persecution comes, only the committed will survive. Oh. When the persecution breaks out, only those fully committed to Christ will remain. Don't get caught up. Don't get caught up in the woman in red. How to overcome her? Get connected to Christ. Be committed to follow Him. And lastly, be comforted by God's Word. Notice what it says. For God put it into their hearts to fulfill His purposes, to be of one mind, and to give their kingdoms to the beast until the words of God are fulfilled. I got news for you. The Word of God is going to be fulfilled. One day, some way, somehow, this book is going to be fulfilled. Every prophecy, every promise will be taken care of. I don't want to be a part of that compromising church. See, the first thing the compromising church has to do is they've got to start doubting the Word. Here's what you hear. You know the world really wasn't created in 7 days. It was a big bang. It took eons and millions and bazillions of years. Yeah? Oh, you know that Jesus could not have been born of a virgin. That's just a mythological story because that's physically impossible. There was no bodily resurrection. See, you hear those kind of things all the time because you got to do away with the book because the book says it's going to be fulfilled. So you got to start questioning the book. Oh, you Christians, you've got it all wrong because you think you've got the only way to heaven. There are many paths. Oh, let me tell you, Jesus said something completely different. He said, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. You know, we're arrogant because we claim that we know the truth. No one religion can have all the truth. See, we hear those arguments all the time. But I'm here to tell you, God's Word will be fulfilled. Everything that happens is the fulfillment of God's perfect will or His permissive will. Everything. And you know what? That should encourage me. That should encourage me that whatever's going on, God's got it. Whatever's going on, God's got it. Turn to the person on your right, the person on your left, and say, I don't know what's going on in your life, but I know this, God's got it. Tell them right now. All right, let's wrap it up. Let's wrap it up real quickly. So how in the world can I overcome the woman in red? Three things need to happen. I got to be connected to Him. I got to be committed to Him. I got to be confident and confirmed that His Word is true. First, I've got to admit that I'm a sinner, that I desperately need a Savior. The reality is everybody in this room, we're all in the same boat. We're all sinners. The Bible makes it clear, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We are in a position, in a condition that we cannot change on our own. We need a Savior desperately. I've got to admit that I'm a sinner. It's not about I'm okay, you're okay. Here's the truth. I'm not okay, and neither are you. We're all broken. We need a Savior. Here's the good news. I can believe that Jesus died for me. Jesus came and died on the cross in my place. He took my punishment. He took your punishment. All I've got to do is believe that He did it for me. I've got to come to that place in my life where I'm committed to believe that what He did was personal, that it was for me. And lastly, I must commit myself to follow Him. I have to make a choice that I'm going to walk with Him, that I'm going to let Him be a part of my life, that I'm going to let Him lead me and guide me and direct me, that I'm going to try to seek to spend time with Him and to learn from Him so that His nature becomes my nature, so that His life becomes my life. Here's the good news. Jesus did for me what He required of me so He could live in me and work through me. That is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's bow together.